Thank you very much, and thank you so much also for the birthday wishes. It's very encouraging. So thank you. It makes me really feel blessed to have all of you as family. So thank you very much. You're all welcome to church service this morning. It's a beautiful day, and we just pray that it's not as hot as some parts of Nigeria. So I pray that you will stay hydrated, even if it's hot. I would like to invite us to be in a standing position. As we take the call to worship, you will realize that beginning from this Sunday, we're more and more trying to get some more things back. You notice that the offering is gone from there. I believe Dave and the team that is assisting him will get the offerings today. And we're going to continue to trust God that we will keep moving forward. Can I have an amen for that? Amen. That's great. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs.
Know that the Lord is God. He is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name.
The Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
We begin in the name of the Lord who made us.
Let us sing and worship together as we praise God's holy name.
Amen. Let's pray together. Gracious Lord, we are thankful to you because we are alive and we can come before your presence. And Lord, we thank you because your presence never leaves us. But as we come together as a household of faith, some are here this morning and some are with us through Zoom. Father, I pray that you accept our praises, you accept our worship, you sanctify us more and more, O God, that we will be in the image and likeness of Jesus Christ. That as we grow, O God, in knowing you through our services, through our songs, through our offerings and the announcements and the message and communion this morning, I pray, O God, that you refresh our spirit. You draw us closer to you, O Lord, that we will realize that we have no any other God than you, and that you are dependable, and that you are in control of our lives, and that we can confidently lay all our burdens before you. So as we worship anything that wants to stand between us and you, Lord, I pray that you take it away and just receive all the glory and honor and speak to us whatever burdens we have, whatever cares, whatever worries, whatever thing that weighs us down. I pray that in the name of Jesus, dear Lord, that you help us to release it unto you and to be in an attitude of worship. And even when we leave, we'll continue to be in worship of the great and mighty God that is our God, because we pray everything through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. And we're going to take the opening hymn, When Morning Gilds the Sky.
Christ be praised. may be seated. Good morning and welcome to the Sunday worship service. There are attendance pads on the hooks in your pew. Please sign it and pass it down. The flowers on the altar are given by Chick and Mary Shadwinkle in honor of Valerie and Michael Baker and their anniversaries. Wednesday midweek meditation will resume September 15th, 2021. An open house card shower in honor of Chick and Mary Shadwinkle's 50th wedding anniversary will be held today from 4 to 6 p.m. here in the Fellowship Hall. Please come and help them celebrate. Sherry Peterson's retirement party will be Sunday, June 13th from 1:30 to 3:30 in the Fellowship Hall following the Share Bears graduation at 1 p.m. The Highway 20 United Methodist Network picnic will be Saturday, June 19th at 12 p.m. at Shadron State Park. All church members are invited to attend for a time of fellowship, food, and fun. For more information, contact Vicki Koshwar at 308-430-3121 or Pastor Gideon at 978-223-5126. The UMW rummage sale will be Thursday and Friday, June 17th and 18th from 9 to 5, and Saturday, June 19th will be a dollar a bag day. The United Methodist Church is accepting applications for the position of Director of Ministries. This person will work closely with the pastor and other ministry leaders, coordinate children, youth, and outreach ministries, help strengthen the spiritual life of the congregation through relationships, nurturing, caregiving, and providing resources to committees, small groups, and individuals. Applications can be picked up at the church office and be accepted until the position is filled. If you have any prayer requests or concerns, call the church office or message us on our Facebook page. If you wish to give online, please see our Facebook page and click the Shop Now button. If you have any questions, feel free to call Renita or me at the church. We are excited to hold VBS this year. The dates will be July 19th through the 23rd, 9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Participant ages are kindergarten through fourth grade. So if you would like to fill your morning with VBS fun, laughter, and time with Jesus, call or text Annette at 308-760-7755. Roger Clark is once again playing in the Summit Christian College Golf Fundraiser. One of the Summit's goals is to have its graduates equipped to enter Christian ministry or the mission field without any worry of student debt. This fundraiser is a major part of achieving that goal. This year, Roger will match up to $250 of the money donated. Donations have to be to him by June 17th. If you would like to donate, you can mail it to Roger Clark or you can text him at 308-760-2168 to arrange for a pickup, or you may talk to him after the service. Thank you.
Before I get to the report about annual conference, I do need to mention something about the rummage sale. You may have noticed that we're selling on Thursday and Friday instead of just Friday this year because we have a lot of stuff in our storage room where it's been put over the whole last year because we didn't have either one of our rummage sales last year. We also would be very, very grateful for any help that any of you could give in setting up on Tuesday and Wednesday, putting all the stuff out. We'll probably move the tables and try and get most of the stuff from the storage room down to Fellowship Hall on Monday. And then on Tuesday, we'll be here from 9 to 5 setting up stuff. You don't have to come all day. If you can come for a couple hours or a morning or an afternoon, we would be very grateful for your help because it's a huge undertaking, but it's also a lot of fun. And the workers have food provided, so there's lunch and cinnamon rolls in the morning with our cinnamon roll ladies that always help us out. So just keep that in mind. And that's next week. Not this week, next week. annual conference this year was last weekend, Thursday and Friday and Saturday. It was very different again because it was on Zoom. And it's hard not being in the big auditorium convention center with all the ministers and all the other lay representatives from the churches all across Nebraska and Kansas. Just like watching church at home on the TV, you kind of miss some of the things. But I want to thank you for allowing me to be your lay delegate to annual conference, and I get to give a report. It's, like I said, it's hard seeing the people. You miss seeing the people that you know. You miss seeing the former ministers that we've had and their families who are sometimes there. The usual reports that are done at annual conference were all done and voted on, and they had a voter system where you could vote on your computer, yes or no, for the things that were presented. Most of the things were passed. The business of the conference was handled because it has to be handled every year. They were they recognized pastors and others. They might be like local lay preachers. They might be deacons, elders, full pastors that are full elders. I can't remember what it's called. Full elders? Okay, full elders. I didn't write that down. Who have completed all their course of studies. They recognize those who had worked on their education things during the year and completed their course of the studies. The Council on Finance report was very interesting. A couple years ago, they were charged with selling off the three previous conference offices because when the Nebraska conference combined with Kansas East and Kansas West, each of those previous conference offices had facilities that they owned where the conference office people and the bishops did their work. Well, when we combined into one conference, they didn't need those surplus things. So the Council on Finance was charged with selling those facilities. And they reported that they had done so. And the conference is presently leasing office space. And since the other properties had been sold, the council was charged with finding a property and making plans to build our own conference offices that'll fit the needs so we don't have to lease from someone else to have our conference offices. The Council on Finance also reported that the investment funds that they have are doing very well. And because of this, they are able to offer grants and monies for churches wanting to start a new ministry that they maybe don't have the funds for. So the Council on Finance is able to offer grants for various ideas and projects that churches have to take care of. They also celebrated and mentioned the churches who were celebrating their 100th or their 125th or their 150th anniversaries of being a Methodist church in their communities. The pastors who are retiring this year were honored. A sad part, there were several churches who are closing, and these closings were read, and I kind of like what Bishop Sines says when the churches are closing. He said, you know, the churches were there, they served their communities, they ministered to the people in their towns, they sent people out from their church to minister. Maybe they had people who became ministers out of their congregation. And now they have decided that it's time to close for whatever reason. Maybe their congregation has shrunk so much, or their town. Maybe the town is dwindling away and the churches are closing. And Bishop Sines says, it's a new season in their life. They've gone through whatever, and this is just a new season in the life of that particular church. And there were several of those. Another sad thing was there were four churches throughout the conference who had voted to disaffiliate from the United Methodist Church because the ideas of the people in their congregation did not line up with the ideas and beliefs of the United Methodist Church. So that's sad too, but there were four churches who have decided to leave the United Methodist Church and go off on their own. And one good thing is that they are already making plans for next year to have conference in person in La Vista. So that's what I have for you from Amherst Conference. It's always a fun time and a good thing to learn. I learned so much the very first year I went, you know, things you don't realize that happen in the churches. And we have to do the business things of the church as well as the worship and the making people feel good and knowing Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Lee,
for that report. And just to add, immediately after the conference, the Council of Bishops voted to add Central Texas Conference to Bishop Sines. So he's going to be taking care of the Great Plains Conference, which is Nebraska and Kansas. And the bishop of the Central Texas Conference is retiring with effect from January, because there's not going to be a jurisdictional conference where bishops are elected. So Bishop Sines gets to add to his basket of, you know, to-do lists, I mean, leadership, you know, the Central Texas Conference. So we need to pray for our bishop. I know he's familiar with that conference very well because he came from there. So pray for him as he leads that conference up until possibly in November of 2022, when there will be a jurisdictional conference where new bishops will be elected, and they likely will just have a new bishop then. So pray for him. And the exciting thing I want to buttress that Mary Lee said, some of you have been in the United Methodist for a long time. There once was a time where every church the membership of every church will be counted, and they are given apportionment based on their membership. So you pay your apportionment based on that. We are thankful to God because we have moved past that. Our apportionment is not given based on the number of membership, but based on the church vitality. And then money was usually just coming from the local churches. But now, particularly this conference is very committed to supporting the local churches with the monies that they are making from investments and other ways to give back to the ministries that are run by the conference, or sometime a church can write for a grant, and that grant, if you have a proposal of a certain ministry you want to do, that could be approved and given to you. So we're thankful that this is happening, and the whole idea is not just bring money, but the whole idea now is we want to see The conference wants to see the churches grow and the churches are involved in ministry. So it's a praise. It's something that we need to thank God for. I want us to continue to be in prayer for Jureen Green. She moved to Highland Park and she's doing well. I'll be seeing her tomorrow. I tried to see her and the nurses said, no, we can only give you an appointment for tomorrow. So I'll be seeing her tomorrow and just spending some time to see how she's doing. Let's also be thankful for our brother, our friend, Scott Dobson. He had some tests done, I think, within the last week, and the results came back really good. So we are praising God for what he's doing in the life of Scott. And we're also thankful for Mike Carr, who is getting back to work. And let's continue to pray for him as he will get back and that God will continue to give him patience, even as he fully immerses himself back to his normal routines. And I want us to pray for Sally Barber and her family. She is not here this morning, and I believe she's not doing really well. So pray for the family, especially her brother and her niece. Pray that God will touch them. And Greg has a procedure on Friday. So just pray for Greg that next Sunday he will be up and standing and doing really well. Right, Greg? Yeah, so let's be in prayer for him. And we're so glad that we have our ushers helping us. I will invite them forward and we pray together and we take the offerings. Let's be in prayers. Father, not only that you've given us eternal life, but you've given us blessings of resources and you've touched our hearts. You've made this, O God, to be a thing that we can live and serve and enjoy our lives together by having all these blessings. Now, as we give a little bit from what you've given us, we ask for your blessings on it, that as we serve and do your ministry with the resources you've given us, you will continue to guide and lead us in the right direction. And Lord, we just thank you, O God, and we are offering even all the items that we brought before you, those that are sick, those that are not doing well, the annual conference, and everything that pertains us, Lord, we bring to you. And we are asking that you take thou the glory and honor. And Father, O Lord, you will lead in every aspect of our lives. And as we continue now with the ushers taking this, O God, let this be an offering of our lives unto you as we serve you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks. Thank you. Let's stand together. Let's be seated.
Our scripture reading is from Philippians 1, 1 through 11. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart, and whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Christ Jesus to the glory and praise of God. Alrighty, it's children's time, so all the babies and the children can come forth.
Good morning, everybody. I know all of you really well, don't I?
Yeah.
Uh-oh, that could be trouble. He is my son, yes, he is. All right, well, today, Pastor Gideon is gonna talk to us about depending on God in our life because God is in control. And of course, I spent my days searching for a story to relate as best as I could. We all have people in our lives that we trust to keep us safe and carry us through even the scariest times. For some of you, it may be your mom and dad, an aunt or uncle, a brother or sister, or even your grandparents. For this story, for me, it was my husband and God. And for my kids who were very young on this day, it was me and their dad and their grandma. For my husband, it was God. It was a beautiful hot day, and we went with our family to the lake and put our boat in the water to take the kids, grandpa, and dad fishing. It was a wonderful sunny day, and we had a great time out on the water. In just a matter of a few minutes, the clouds rolled in really fast, the wind got cold, and it got very scary looking. At this time, the truck and the boat trailer were at the campsite, and the boat was in the water. We were out in the middle of the lake. The wind picked up quickly, and we needed to get that boat out of the water. My husband got me and the boys and their grandma to the truck as quickly as he could. We raced across the water as fast as we could. I'm sure he was nervous because he was in control of all of our lives at that very moment and getting us safely out of the water. But as he always said, he relates to God best in God's earth, wherever he is on the wonderful waters created by our Lord or walking the hills with God's creatures. That being the place that he best talks to God. He put control in God's hands that day. He said a short prayer to himself to let him get him and his family to the safety and then get that boat out of the water. And he did just that. He got us all safely out of the water. And then he had to race back across the lake to the boat dock. Now he had to give God more control over what happened next. You see, we were a ways away from the loading dock and the storm was rolling in very fast. And me and grandma loaded the kids in the truck, and as fast as possible, we got the truck and trailer to the loading dock, and we sat there, and we waited, because it took him a long time to get that boat across those rough waters. And in that time, I said a small prayer. I was scared, and I wasn't sure where he was at or if he was going to make it. And then all of a sudden, there he was. I could see him racing that boat across the water as fast as he could to the boat dock. It was in that moment that I knew God was in control of all of this. And if you've ever had to load a boat in the water when it's wavy out, you know how hard and dangerous it can be. My kids and grandma saw him coming, and the boat was rocking and it was hard to navigate. But in all of God's control, their father was able to get it close enough to the trailer. I kept the kids still and calm and let them know that Dad had control. And grandma backed the truck down a little further down the ramp so Dad could get it on the trailer. As best as he could, he ran that boat up on the trailer, and it didn't go on the way that it should have because of the wind and the waves. He had to jump out of the water and get on the trailer, and he pulled and tugged with all his strength and might on that boat to get it on the trailer correctly. He's a very strong man, a good man, and a God-trusting man. And he did. He got that boat on the trailer and all of us back to the camper safely. He was nervous and scared, I am sure, though he'll never admit it, because that's what dads do. They try to hide their fears from their loved ones because their families trust them to have control and keep them safe. But fathers trust in God, just as we trust in them, to keep us safe and protected every day. That day, he did just that. He trusted in God to get that boat out of the water and on the trailer and get his family to safety. All of God's creatures were at risk of danger by that boat and that storm. All the animals in the water. God wanted harm to none of them, and had that boat been left in the water, it could have flipped over and spilled oil and gas and been littered with all our supplies from the boat, causing danger and harm to the fish and turtles in the water. And the danger of his people, my family, in the water could have easily been a loss of life. But because we had faith in God and we let him take control of that day and guide us safely to get the people to safety and the boat out of the water, all of God's creatures were safe and together. We have to trust in God and in his control. We have to trust him the same way we do our parents, our grandparents, our aunts, uncles, and even our brothers and sisters. We have to listen to those instincts that help make those right and wrong choices in life. Depend on God, because ultimately he is in control. And let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your plan, and help me to remember that you are in control, even when things seem scary. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jamie, for applying that very clearly, and thank you for sharing with the kids. You know, human beings, all of us at one point or the other will always love to be on the driver's seat. We want to be the ones that are in charge. We want to be in control. We want to actually see that things go the way we want them to go, but sometimes they don't go that way. And sometimes when they go not in the way we expect, that causes anxiety and pressure in us, And sometimes it causes anger and it causes frustration. And we just feel like, why can't I just, you know, you just feel like you want to change things and make them be the way you want. But it is not always, it doesn't happen that way all the time, that you are taking charge and are being in control of everything. You know, sometimes when we look at the things that are happening around us and around the world, we are tempted to wonder if God is still in control, actually. If we are not in control, then is God in control? Many things happen in life, and we are forced sometimes to ask, where is God when bad things happen to good people? We read from the first chapter of Philippians, a letter written by Paul to the church in Philippi. But I want us to know one thing. If you really want to get an understanding of what was going on here, you probably need a little bit of the background. And I will actually advise you, if you want to know more of the background, you go back home and read Acts chapter 16. The book of Acts chapter 16, you will see so much of the background. Then you will appreciate the book of Philippians as Paul wrote it to the church in Philippi. The Holy Spirit literally stopped Paul from preaching in other places that he wanted to preach, because he was a traveling evangelist. He was going around after his first missionary journey from chapter 13. If you read from chapter 13 of Acts and chapter 14, he went out on his first missionary journey. And there were so many questions and there were so many things. So he went back to headquarters, and that was in Jerusalem. And then he told the council of elders and said, okay, now I have this problem. All over the regions I preached, and there are these questions. Well, these Gentiles people, they just eat whatever food they get and everything. Must we force them to eat what we as Jewish people eat, or not to eat what we eat? Like, one of it was pork. I wonder how that would have fared in the United States. You know, we have all kinds of, you know, different variations of pork that we eat. So, but the Jewish people, that was a taboo. That was not allowed. So people were being converted to Christ, and they were having this conflict. Should they be Christians and still eat pork, for example? So Paul came back to headquarters in Jerusalem, reported, and they sat down and met and took a decision in chapter 15. That was the meeting of the council. And then chapter 16, which is the background to what we are seeing today, Paul now started going back and preaching and reporting the decision of how they should live as Christians. Because it's not what we eat and put inside us that make us righteous or not. But he was telling them. Now, Paul wanted to preach and go to certain regions, but literally the Holy Spirit stopped him. Said, no, don't go there. Don't go there. And at night, he saw a man in a vision. And the man actually told him, come over to Macedonia and help us. The next morning, Paul, Silas, and their companions, they left and traveled all the way. And there we understood they got to Philippi. And it happened that they met a lady, Lydia, because it was the Sabbath, they went to pray by the sea, because there was no synagogue there. And they met this group of ladies. To fasten the story very fast, they saw what God was planning to do there. Some of these people came to Christ. Paul continued to preach. They spent some time there, meeting in the house of Lydia, and they were preaching, and people were coming to Christ. And all in all, they would go out and come back. So there was this lady, this small girl, that had demons in her. She had evil spirit. And the evil spirit will always foretell whatever will happen to people. And then the owner of the girl, the slave girl, will get money in return. And this kept harassing Paul day and night whenever they go out. So Paul rebuked the spirit, and the spirit left. And it became a problem. They took Paul and reported him to the magistrate. And what happened? Paul was beaten. Silas was beaten. They put them in prison and jailed them for doing something good. So, but the church was planted there. And the believers in Christ were fellowshipping together. And you would imagine and wonder, Paul preaching and doing good and even casting out the evil spirit in this girl ended up in prison. And you wonder why bad things happen to good people. There are times that things happen to us and we wonder, God, why is this happening to me? Or why is it happening to that person? Well, to fast forward, 10 years later, Paul had continued to preach. And he had encountered another situation through preaching the gospel, and he was shipped to Rome and was put in prison there again. So he was there, even though he was jailed. Today, we may not understand it because we understand that people are in prison and the government feed them. No, that was not what was happening. They had to take care of themselves even though they were prisoners. So Paul was depending on the support of the people of God even while he was there. Paul did not just sit in prison and died in self-pity. He was not saying, why me? No, he continued to do God's work. In fact, Philippians is one of the four letters in the New Testament that Paul wrote from prison. So he wrote back to the church in Philippi while he was in prison. Because this church had grown and actually had become one of the strongest supporters of Paul's ministry. The church had sent Paul some gifts while he was in prison. So Paul wrote back to them because they themselves, he wanted to encourage them because they needed the encouragement from Paul. And Paul also gave an example for us to see how we can respond when things are not going in the way we expect. When we think that God is no longer in control. So in his epistle, in his letter, in the first chapter, here we see a few things that he did that we can learn from. And number one is the fact that prayer is living as though God is in control. Prayer is living as though God is in control. Because sometimes we think of prayer just like asking God for help or do, but it's beyond that. Prayer is actually an affirmation of our faith and complete dependence on the Holy Spirit, on God Himself, knowing that no matter what the situation is, He is in control. In verse 3 and 4, Paul remembered the church in prayers. And humanly speaking, the circumstances around Paul's memories about Philippi and his current circumstance wouldn't have actually even led him to say, the first thing I want to do is to pray. Because his memory of Philippi was beaten and jailed. That was how it all started. And his current circumstance was that he was under a confined space too. Because he was in prison in Rome. So sometime we begin to ask God, we begin to complain about things that are happening to us when things don't go the way we expect. But when we turn to prayer, it's an indication that we are living as though God is in control despite every situation. Listen, in verse 3 and 4, he said, I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. Wow. What is supposed to be, Paul at this time, I think was supposed to be complaining. He was supposed to be whining. He was supposed to actually begin to have self-pity for himself. But no, what he did was that he prayed. He went back to God. He knew that God was in control. A man in prison and thinking the first thing he thought of is to pray. It's an example for us. And not just praying, but he said, I remember you in my prayer. I give thanks to God in my prayer for you when I remember you. And I always pray with joy. This is an attitude that we can learn, that when things seem to be outside of our control, we need to come back to God. We need to be in prayer. Because Paul chose to come down to his knees in prayer and see things from the perspective of God rather than his painful circumstance. You know, a wise man once said that prayer is man reduced to his proper proportion before God, who is in control. Let's get that again. Prayer is man reduced to his proper proportion before God, who is in control. Because what we are on our knees is what we are before God. This is something that we need to remember and think of as God's children, that whoever you are, whoever I am on my knees, that is who I am before God. This invites us to take seriously the idea of praying instead of complaining, the idea of letting God be in control and being in his presence and just saying, God, this is beyond me. That's even prayer. You come to God and say, Lord, I don't have answers to this, but you do. You do. And I don't want to bother myself about this. I cannot change it, but I'm coming to you in prayers. And you know, when we do that, God moves into action. God does things that are beyond our imagination. And even things that we don't understand, he understands and he knows. And when we let him be in control, he will take those things and change them and make them the way that will bring praise and honor unto him. So that's one example for us to live as though God is in prayers. The second example that I see here when Paul wrote in this first chapter is the fact that partnership is living as though God is in control. Partnership is living as though God is in control. You know, the idea of partnership sometimes is difficult, especially in a culture that is individualistic. In a culture where we actually want individual heroism, whereby I want to be seen as the one that is doing it. I want to be seen as the one that is, you know, I mean, it's me. No, but Paul taught us something here, that partnership is living as though God is in control. Paul was emphasizing the importance of the church in Philippi covenanting together with him to carry out God's mission. The church actually sent one of their leaders. History has it that one of their leaders left Philippi. And this is not like just living from here to Scott's Bluff. They were way far away. They chose him. They came together. They had been praying for Paul. They did not stop by praying. They now got gifts together and took one of their leaders and said, you need to go to Rome and take this to Paul. And because of that, Paul was able to continue with his ministry even in prison. And in verse 5, where we read, because of your partnership, this is what the verse said, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And in verse 7, he said, it is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart, and whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. There's nobody that can do it alone. No one. The church will not be the church if it is just one person that is the hero. Whoever that person is, no matter how strong that person is, no matter how weak that person is, no matter how much that person wants to be, if you have a church where you have people, individuals want to be heroes, that church will not live as God wanted it to be, because God made the church to be a community knitted together in partnership, carrying out God's mission. And you know what happens when that is going on? You see the excitement because everybody is involved. Paul understood that because of the partnership of the church in Philippi, he is where he is. He is able to do what he is doing. You know, without partnership, it would be like a single dad leaving Alliance and taking a flight to Disneyland and just walking around by himself. Do you understand what that means? You go to Disneyland and you're walking alone. Disneyland was designed for families. It was designed with kids in mind. It was designed where people can be together and enjoy the experience together. The church was designed where people can be together to enjoy the experience together. Paul recognized this, and that is what he made clear to them. He said that because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, he went on to indicate that that is how he's able to do what he is doing. When God is in control in the way we do church, we will be in community with one another. God being at the center of our church life, we will make friends even out of enemies. We will make friends with people who are of a different socioeconomic class. And that's how we are able to make friends, even with people who are different than us. Because we come into the church and all of a sudden, everybody become a brother and a sister in Christ. So, and if we have that, you will realize that God is in control, because if anything happens, for instance, to Freddie here, it happens to all of us. And then we'll see how God is in control. That's how it is. So, partnership is living as though God is in control. Reach out to somebody. Somebody that probably is not in your circle of friends. Reach out to someone in the church and say to him, how are you doing? And really mean it. You know, sometimes we meet with people and say, how are you? We don't really mean to know how they're doing, right? We don't really mean it. But reach out to them and look at them in the face and say, hey, let's say, Bob, how are you doing? And I should be willing to be patient, to listen to Bob. Once we are able to do that, Bob will be able to trust the community he belongs as a church. and he will share. But there are sometimes, because of the way we live as individuals, even when I reach out to Bob, for instance, say, Bob, how are you? Bob will not be confident to share with me because I've had nothing to do with him. And that's not what is happening in this church, I believe, right? Let's partner with one another. Let's be knitted together. Let's continue to run together and support one another in our various Christian lives. That was what Paul was telling us here. And that was showing that God is in control of every situation because everyone is actually upholding the other. God designed the church to be a community. And finally, we can learn the lesson of the fact that perseverance is living as though God is in control. When you persevere, when you continue, and when you don't give up, you are giving it to God but not giving it up. Then you will see that God takes control of everything. What is this perseverance about anyway? Paul prayed for the Philippian church that their love for God and for each other will persevere through knowledge and depth of insight. Despite the challenges we have, we need to persevere through knowledge and the knowledge of the Son of God and the depth of insight in the love that Christ has for us. Because if there is anything, there are people that you feel like just walking out of their lives. There are people that you just feel like, I don't even want to see him or her. I don't want to have anything to do with them. But when we are focused in the knowledge of God and we persevere through that knowledge and the depth of insight that God has for us, then it makes a difference. Perseverance is our embrace of God's power. It is the embrace of God's power. We need to continue to persevere. You know, when we live our lives knowing that God is in control, we will learn to depend on Him. It is only through our dependence on what He has accomplished for us on the cross that we are able to wake up and face each day with its challenge that comes. And one of the things that He does, or Jesus did, was to remind us of communion. That when we take it, we remember what He did for us so that we can persevere, we can continue, we can move on, and God will continue to help us to be the people He has called us to be. So this morning, I want us, as we persevere in our lives, as we continue to allow God to be the one that is in control, I want to invite us to communion. And with that, we'll continue to get the strength to let God be in control. So on the night in which Christ gave Himself up, the Bible tells us that Jesus, on that night, He took bread and He gave thanks to God. He broke it and gave thanks and said to them, "This is my body that is broken for you. Take, eat in remembrance of me." And the Bible tells us that after supper, Jesus took the cup and He said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for me. Take this, drink in remembrance of me. And as often as you do this, you proclaim my death and resurrection." So, this is what He has given us for the forgiveness of our sins. And He wants us to take it together. And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts, In Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I will invite the communion stewards to come forward and help me here. Now I invite all of us to come forward as we take communion together. Thank you. Dear Lord, we thank you for what you've done for us. We thank you because even in our brokenness, Jesus was the one that died so that we can be healed. Lord, as we have taken communion this morning, give us the strength, the courage, the faith to lay down our burdens before you and know that you are in control. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand and join with me as we sing our closing hymn, Here I Am, Lord.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright, I will hear my light.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all as you live your lives, knowing that God is in control of all.
every situation of your life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.